So I would like to invite my panelist, Ms. Manal. Round of applause for her, please. Mr. Yasin Pasha and Mr. JD Alex. Good afternoon, everyone. It's an absolute delight and pleasure to be here, and a topic very close to my heart. So today we are going to discuss about modeling and place-based STEM education. We already got an idea as terms of what we are expecting out of this panel. Now, it's no secret the importance of STEM education in tomorrow's world. In fact, it's said that in a decade's time, the talent that would be needed, it doesn't exist. We are not aware of what kind of talent will be needed to have the jobs that will be there in a decade's time. But we all know that it's all about digitization. It's all tomorrow is about the STEM education. And it's so very important to prepare our students for it. It's also about finding the local solutions to the problems and giving these children the hands-on, low-cost kind of technology so that they are able to play and innovate and therefore harness their innovation, their curiosity, their engagement levels at the schools. So we have with us a very esteemed panelist that I would like to quickly introduce. Just next to me is Ms. Manal from Abu Dhabi. She's the head of science department at Al Hasad Private School, and also the Eco Club and Sustainable Schools Initiative coordinator. She worked with the United Nations as an educator for several years before joining AYPS. She is committed to assisting students to become leaders, critical consumers of scientific concepts and skills, and problem solvers by creating sustainable solutions for a better future. She has recently contributed to Action Research Project and penned down chapter to influence science learning. Wow, what better person can we have on the stage for this topic? A round of applause for her, please. Next to Manal is a gentleman who is from my same place we come, Bangalore, Mr. Yasin Pasha, who is the CEO of Arafa Group of Institutions and Arafa International School. He graduated from Bangalore University and along the way acquired skills of creativity, teamwork, leadership while earning several laurels. He had always felt the need for providing a comprehensive model of education and thus established the school in the year 2013 with the sole aim of providing quality education and create future leaders. He envisions to expand to other parts of the world, starting with UAE, and continue his diligent efforts in providing the students with high quality, holistic education. Excellent, Mr. Yasin, welcome. And a round of applause for him, please. Well, now, the last but not the least, we are joined by Mr. JD Alex from Singapore, who is the founder of Coaching Changes Lives and is an expert at leadership coaching. He has worked and partnered globally with organizations and teams from across cultures and diversity to create sustainable change, team performance, and building a learning culture. He has been recognized as the top 10 global leaders coaches by Influencer 2020 and awarded the top 100 global leaders in the Education Award by GFEL, and also the recipient of the top 101 global coaching leaders awarded by the World HRD Congress. With over a span of 14 years of coaching and impacting lives, he believes the coaching is the key to creative, positive, impactful, and lasting changes in people. It's absolute a pleasure to have with you all, looking forward to a very engaging session. So my first question is from Ms. Manal. Now, as a person with a background of being a science educator and having worked with the global bodies, what is your view in terms of having the necessity to adopt the STEM education among the students? So as a teacher, would love to hear your point of view and any of the real-time examples that you would like to share with the audience.
Okay, hi everyone. Thanks Archana for the nice introduction for every one of us. As you mentioned that preparing today's students for tomorrow is focused in learning the STEM, in STEM education or learning STEM activities and the development of STEM programs. STEM programs or STEM educations are very important nowadays. Now there is development of technology and coding programs. These requires more skills from the students. By STEM programs, the students can develop their problem-solving skills, creativity, innovation, so they will be able to think outside the box and find solutions to real-life problems. The STEM activities help students to develop the 21st and 22nd century skills, which are for the 21st century, we have mainly the creativity, innovation, communication, and also for the 22nd century skills, we have care, culture, community. And this is the main core of STEM education, where the students will start working with the community, implement activities and initiatives outside the school, outside the classroom. Just I'll mention certain activities that we are implementing in our schools, like our students participate in many activities in coordination with the, and collaboration with the Environment Agency of Abu Dhabi. They have the Sustainable Schools Initiative program, where the students will find solutions for environmental problems, implement, conduct researches, implement certain STEM projects to find solutions to have a better and a sustainable environment. Also, we have Masdar, also they have the Sustainability Ambassador Program, where many of our students participate in this initiative also. They will attend many workshops, implement different STEM activities, and all these initiatives and activities develop the leadership, the teamwork, the patience, the resilience of our students. For this, the STEM education is very important for our students to have a future scientist and future leaders who are successful, innovative, and creative.
Thanks. That's very interesting. And I really like the fact that when you mentioned that besides the science, technology, engineering, math, what is equally important is also teaching children in terms of care to the community. This is so very important because we have to develop the children holistically for tomorrow. I would just like to give an example from the organization that I come, Dell Technologies. So what we are working in India is that we have partnered with the government. It's called the Niti Aayog, which is the planning commission. And through our NGO partners, one of our strategic partners is also here in the audience, Learning Links Foundation, where we are trying to cultivate the culture of innovation and curiosity amongst the young children. And therefore, through them, what we are seeing is that they are solving the real life problems that their communities face by themselves. It was so heartening that recently the group of girls, they're basically two to three girls from Maharashtra, which is on the western part of our country. They come from a very remote location where they were facing water problems. Basically, the water over there was not very pure. So through the sensors and through the tinkering labs that they go to within the school, they were able to find a solution to it. So while these children, we are really through these STEM education, we are trying to make them think out of the box, and they are able to solve problems of tomorrow. So it was very relevant. And over to you, sir. You know, like you are running a group of schools. Do you see that in your schools you are able to implement the STEM education? How is it being perceived by your teachers and the students. Would love to hear a first-hand view about in terms of rolling it out and the kind of response that you're getting from your students.
Hi, everyone. As you know, I'm from a management background. Like, I have started a school. I'm not like a teacher. So let me speak on behalf of management like that. So see, as usual, I started my school around 8 years back. And alhamdulillah, I've done the research a lot on the education part. So we started with the current curriculum of the state. So later I realized that students, they want something more. Like we usually, the traditional teachings and all is based on just memorizing the subjects and all. So for example, today morning we had one session from NTTF company. What they are doing, once the engineers are passed, some other professions are passed, they are training on machines, hands on the other things. The same thing, why can't we start that from the schooling itself? That is what the STEM is doing, hands on your all your machine, robotics. Like for example, the kids are not like, this generation is changed now. They just don't want only books. They want something more than books. They want to feel what they're learning. They want to, they're very smart, like for games and all. They use their smartphones. So why can't we do this with the education itself? So this was what I was thinking on. So later, we, in India, like the STEM, it's growing now. Like I've seen in Dubai, mashallah, most of the schools are doing that. And it's a challenging part. There are lots of companies who have come down now in India who are implementing this STEM. And we are in the beginning stage of this. And we have seen a very good response in this.
Thank you. JT, you are a coach. You interact with senior leaders from all over the globe. How do you see the response from their end? You know, they are already the achievers. And they are the so-called, the successful lot. How do you see their response? And how do you also see their involvement in this very important aspect?
Well, one of the most important things for us to first consider, it's how relevant is STEM for management, for senior leaders, for senior executives as well, managing the future leaders? For one, we first have to consider the students currently in schools, how they're transiting through the different career stages. So in considering this, we first have to understand, hey, the world is changing. Students' learning appetites are changing, the learning styles are different, and the way we engage them have to be different. So senior leaders have to relearn or unlearn, relearn, and begin to learn afresh again. So oftentimes I coach senior leaders by asking them to do one thing. I said, hey, what you've been doing so far, or how you've been modeling for the next generation, you got to see different. You got to think different. In the sense that right now, for the leaders as well, we often tell them, hey, you know what? If we can approach learning, not just from a top-down approach, from a hierarchical approach, but more from a collaborative approach, in the sense of co-creation. Earlier in my keynote speech earlier, we talked about the sense of co-creation as learning agility for the future generation. So for senior leaders, now they've got to change and having a coaching mindset that it's not about just teaching. It's not about just lecturing the staff members, but it's about embracing, facilitating, coaching them, and having this dialogue with them so that you can go deeper. Now, when we consider the different functionalities of STEM, we also have to consider not just how it's involved today, but also anticipation for tomorrow. What do we mean by that? It says, how do we begin to learn how to learn? So, for example, if we consider the hautological approach for engagement and learning, or the andragogical approach from learning, we have to consider how adults learn. They learn fundamentally different from how young children learn. And now, as more people are aging gracefully in their senior years, pedagogical learning is different as well. So how seniors learn, how adults learn, how young generation learns across the different generations from Gen Y, Gen Z, and now you have Generation Alpha that's rising up as well, entering the workforce in the next several years. So they are going to bring in all those different elements of what they've learned in school into the workforce. Now, for senior leaders, one of the things that we gain then to do with them is to engage them by helping them to relearn. For example, one of the things that we get them to do is that, hey, you know what? Perhaps it's time for you to learn new technologies. So senior leaders have this aversion to picking out new technologies. So how many of you here are very comfortable using Facebook and Instagram? If you're in the Facebook or Instagram generation, you belong to the senior generation, right? Because the new generations, they're on TikTok. Now, if you're on TikTok today, tomorrow you will belong to the senior generation because there will be a new platform that comes up that will disrupt. How many of you are on Taco or on Clubhouse? You realize that every single generation there comes a new set of engagement of community learning as well. So by that, one thing we begin to learn. At the initial start of several years, 10 years ago when Facebook, YouTube was first formed, there was a consolidation of community learning, peer learning. But as the years go, right now you see what we call a diaspora effect of technology, where many different companies or many different individual groups want to have their own platform of engagement. For example, as a young, when we engage with senior leaders, they are very comfortable. Some of them are using SMS. How many of you are still using SMS? Emails. Now you find a whole new generation that are avoiding emails because they say emails are things of the past. We have to change, right? Now you have seen young generations engaging over Discord, over Twitch, right? They have a new way of engaging. So if we truly want to model after STEM or the future of what STEM will look like, are we embracing this new technology, modeling for them to show them, hey, you know what? We are serious, we're interested in this learning. And having that learning agility is the key cutting edge for what separates good leaders to great leaders and for us to see the potentiality and identification of leaders in the future.
Thanks. Before I go to my panelists for the next set of questions, I would just like to leave it also open to the audience. If there is any question, I give this opportunity in case anybody wants to ask anything. Okay, so I want to share, a real-time kind of a story that happened. Maybe, you know, that can relate more with this topic. In 2020, we had the pandemic in March. When everything started to get close. It was just the time I work on the overall strategy for the year and the planning for the grants. So it was all set, all done by March, mid of March. It was signed off by my leaders and we were all ready to roll it out. When suddenly things were folding slowly as well as very rapidly. When we go back to March of 2020. And that's when we were told that, hey, most of the projects will not be able to be done. And we have to rethink of a strategy because your funds that you have allocated to the partners, maybe we have to divert it towards the COVID-related support. So it really disturbed the whole lot and we had to take quick action. And thankfully, most of our NGO partners that we were working, they were also prepared. And immediately, all the actions that we do with the communities, it went into an hybrid model, where any kind of the skilling sessions, any kind of education that we were doing was in a hybrid model. So there was two learning that I want to share with the audience. A is that what's so important that we have to teach these students and for the future generation is about agility. We cannot have any plans now. Things change rapidly. We all saw in the last 2 years. And this is another thing that the place-based STEM teaches. Because it's all about using your creativity, using your intelligence, and in simple terms, just the common sense, and finding the problems to the issues that's around you. Second thing which is really important and which has taught us is about digitization. There is no alternative to it. So while we talk about the other aspects of life, it's so very important that in today's world, the STEM education is at the heart of it. But having talked all the good things and we all understand the importance, there's no debate about it. I would like to understand from Ms. Minal, because you interact with the students, what are the challenges that you see in terms of adopting it, rolling it out, and perhaps even any kind of an adverse effect of it, if we are talking too much about the science aspect of it?
Okay, the main challenge for our students, or maybe with most many students, the time limitation. For example, till now the STEM programs is not, you will not have specific lessons that under the title STEM. So we are teaching STEM program within the science curriculum, biology, chemistry, or physics. So but we overcome this challenge by offering the students extra lessons. The online learning was helpful for us because now the teacher is able to provide the students with extra lessons at her or his suitable time after school. Like for example, we had a project or a student participated in the National Science Technology and Innovation Festival and Expo 2020 3 weeks ago. Also, they search for a certain problem and they try to extract the ethanol from palm tree, which is a native species in the UAE. So we were working, for example, from 9 to 12 midnight online or from 7 to 10. So this was helpful for the students to complete their proposals, their applications or their activities within these less hours, because during the day it was full schedule either for the teacher or the students. Also, certain challenges that differentiation, or we have students of different abilities. Some students have are low motivated, for example, to do trials and don't give up from failures and repeat the trials. So the teacher here has to be also patient to guide these students to try and be more patient and to find solutions for certain problems. Also, some of the challenges that we have is that sometimes certain facilities are not available for the students. For example, now I'm preparing the senior students to conduct researches and STEM projects at the university level. And you know that there is differences between the lab equipments in schools and university's labs. So as we said, that STEM is to lead or guide the students to start working with the community, not only in the school. So in the future, we will start guiding these students to work or to conduct their labs, maybe in the universities in the future. So mainly these are the challenges. And to differentiate also the STEM activities according to the student level and build up the curriculum in a proper way that is suitable for all the students of different levels.
Thank you. This is very interesting. Mr. Yaseem, now, you know, as a chief executive and running chain of schools, there are a whole lot of things that must be coming to your attention, you know, in terms of different aspects. How do you prioritize STEM in this whole aspect to it? Because, you know, from where you are, there are a lot of other things as well that can take your mind space. But, you know, how do you prioritize and how do you see the challenges in terms of implementing it in your schools?
Yeah, challenges are there. Whenever you start something new at your organization, definitely there are many challenges. But we should see what is the outcome of it. The outcome is very good in that. Students, like, for example, if they are going up with any one project in STEM, they have a group working on one project. It's like there are many skills in that. It's not only that science, technology, engineering, mathematics, even the management skills, hierarchies, like the friends, they decide themselves that if they want to build up something, they divide the work, one person lead in that. So these all things are very good when it comes to the future of the students. And yeah, challenges are there with the regards to this curriculum and all things are happening. And nowadays, the subjects are also changing. The government are also changing. The new policies coming. You are aware of it. In that policies, STEM things are there, science, engineering, and all. So at the end, what I feel is I can find the students' performances better with regards to academics as well. When they are involving themselves into whatever they're learning in the books, if they have in hands on that, and the academics is always good. And this is good for the future itself.
Thanks, Yaseem. It's interesting to note that with a whole lot of other things, also there is students who are finding a lot of interest and you are prioritizing it. This really takes me back to the Atal Tinkering Labs. I mentioned about Dell Technologies partnership with the Niti Aayog, who's the think tank of the country, where we have set up these Atal Tinkering Labs. So I had the opportunity, along with my partner organization, Learning Links, where I visited some of these tinkering labs, which are really in the remote part of the country. Tinkering labs are so remote that they are really in the forest areas where by evening, if they don't wrap up, they will actually see wild animals passing by. But what was heartening that though the journey and reaching was tough, but the school, once I reached out over there, it was just bubbling with energy. And almost the attendance was 100%. And one of the reasons that I got to know that students are encouraged to come to the school is because of that tinkering lab. Because the whole idea is that they're getting the opportunity to play with these 3D models, play with different kinds of equipments, and come out with any kind of an innovation. So to Yasim's point, that children, they also enjoy so much while they are learning. And this is an opportunity that must be given to them. We talk about cutting edge technology for the future, the high tech companies, they all are working towards it. But if we don't have that culture of innovation from the young age, we will not be able to do any kind of future innovations. So that's from a real time example I just wanted to share. Now, Mr. JD, you talk with different leaders and companies. How do you influence while interacting with them? And any kind of an example that you want to share as how you were really able to facilitate this whole thing about STEM in their companies or the schools or in anything that they have been they have been leading?
Thanks for the question. I guess in Singapore, we have this saying, when things gets overwhelming, we call this thing called xian. Right, or we call it sensation. Sensation is the feeling of blandness, the feeling of, I had it too much, it's just too many things. Right, one moment it's this, one moment it's that. So one of the dangers, when we want to kind of increase more and more different modules or concepts or things to teach people, it overwhelms them. And it reaches to a point of saturation point where they feel a sense of blandness, the sensation. So the big question is, how do we move from a place of sensation to sensation? Helping them to feel, hey, you know what, I enjoy. I want to, not because I have to, but because I get to learn. So that has always been my quest. How do we help inspire leaders to not, I have to learn, but I get to learn? In Singapore, one of the things that the government does from a structural standpoint or systemic standpoint is that they support adult education, adult learning, continuous education. They reward companies who help them, whether it's local companies or foreign companies that are in Singapore, to support the people for continuous learning. Because one thing that's really interesting is that the future economy, it's based on people's ability to learn. And one of the examples that I found really, really true was this. I was entering one of the organizations and they came to me and said, Jedi, can you help my teams for team building? So I said, okay, what do you have in mind for team building? Oh, I think we need to go for the obstacle course. We need to bring the people to play and da-da-da-da-da. I said, okay, it's kind of interesting, right? That has been done again and again and again. So whenever people think about team building, they think about going for obstacle course and everything. Nothing wrong with those things. So it's really much similar to technology. Technology is not the solution. Activities are not the solution. There's a process of what we call solutioning. A co-created solutioning is going to be critical because we need to understand what is the gap, what is the needs of those individuals first, and then design those elements inside. And therefore, today, what we need is not just curators of things, but people who are able to create designs or design elements into the learning structure, learning process. So what happens, I sat down with the person and had a coaching conversation with him. I said, hey, what do you hope to get from this team building exercise? What is the purpose behind that? I asked him the why behind the what. The what is the task. The why, it's the motivation behind the task. And I go deeper from the why to the next layer, what we call the who. Because you see, if we start with why, we end up with the motivators, we end up with the triggers. But we have to go down to the who. The who symbolizes the values, the principles, the beliefs, the organizational outcomes, the vision. Everything is encapsulated within the who. So if we begin with the who, we begin to realize, hey, what is it that the organization stands for? What do we live for? People join organizations because of who the organizations are, but the very same thing, they leave organizations because of the leaders that are there with them. So I began to work with them and said, hey, let's go through this process of unraveling what is it that your organization needs. We start from the strategic point. We begin to cascade down in terms of the executables and how those relate to the learning programs for the individuals. And from there, we move away from just traditional team building to what we call team development or team learning development. And so it's no longer just a one-day program or two-day program. How many of you have been to training programs where it's just one day, 2 days, and you expect to learn so many things? So we've moved away from that model to, hey, let's do a bite-sized learning because it's expensive to take people out for 1 day. Let's give them a 2-hour program, 3-hour program, a bite-sized masterclass. And what we do after that is critical. We have a support function, what we call team coaching, where we begin to team coach the team members, not once every other day, but once every single month or once every 2 or 3 weeks, where we begin to apply what was taught in those lessons into their real practice. So assimilating, integrating what is taught. That is also part of Bloom's taxonomy. You know, when we begin to realize, hey, it's not just learning, but it's also applied learning, but also there needs to be a feedback function and feed-forward function so that we know what we have done in the past, how do we improve from there, and how do we anticipate for the future. This double loop cycle of feedback and feed-forward will help leaders and for the future. So from that experience, the leader now began to realize, say, hey, you know, I used to think of training just as a once-off, one-stop solution, but now the solutioning has changed. It's moving away from just trying to team bond, but through the process of team communication, team development, the teams are more gelled together because now they begin to build a team culture, a commonality. You see, one thing that creates sustainability and retention for employees is actually a sense of camaraderie, a sense of team connectedness, team commonality. So HR practitioners always often ask me, say, Jedi, you know, how do we increase retention? How do we engage? How do we acquire? How do we retain, you know, good talents? I said one thing, they must feel that they are involved in the process. They must feel a sense of ownership in what they do. They must feel connected to the cause. They must feel that whatever they do, it's supporting to the higher vision of the organizations. And so organizations today begin to change the structure from more of a bureaucratic structure to holocratic structure in a certain spectrum. And again, we have to look at the organization's vision to see how those things apply accordingly. So that's one simple example. And one of the things I always encourage organizations to do, first, do not copy another organization's. There was another organization who did the opposite. So they heard about Netflix, how they had scrum teams, and they began to have all these little micro teams, and they began to copy what Netflix did. But what ended up happening was this, it failed. So it's not about copying another company. It's taking the learnings and applying them into your organization. And how do you apply that? You need a team coach. You need someone from an external perspective to give you the support function so you can see beyond what you can see from the internal. Really much like the story of the frog in the well, the frog can't see beyond what his eyes can see. So having that partnership between internal coaches and external coaches will help enrich the overall learning and opportunities for the individuals and the organizations. Yeah.
No, that's very interesting, Jedi, because you know what you summed up is really very futurist and what the students can achieve. And you are already seeing that in the future leaders. So it's been a very interesting and engaging session. Before I wrap it up, again, wanted to quickly give an opportunity if there is any question from the audience for our esteemed panelists. Okay, so I wrap up this session. I know it's the end of the day and everybody is just waiting to get home or, you know, just go out for shopping. It's been an absolute pleasure and thank you so much for your words of wisdom. I thoroughly enjoyed and I hope you all had a good time too. Thanks. Yeah.
Thanks, guys, so much. Give them a round of applause, guys. Let's wake up a little bit. We don't want to leave anybody without feeling great on this stage. They've been a great panel. We got a picture. We're still driving live on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn.